You got to say Dawn Staley's name when you're talking about the best basketball coaches alive. You got to say her name. It's crazy what she's doing now.
I don't think the Sixers would be the favorite in that series, but I'm going to pick them to win just for the drama.
But they are expert shit talkers.
Just don't wake them up.
Expert, top level. They will always make fun of you. They will always make fun of you.
Don't wake them up.
More than just watching him play, I'm so excited to hear what he has to say. What's going to happen when they win a big game? What's he going to say? What's he going to say when they lose a big game? It's going to happen. He has my attention. What? What? So in San Antonio, it was full total eclipse, total blackout.
Yeah.
Was it like that in LA?
No. It was like partial. It was like the bottom little bit of it. We had a nice clear view, no clouds in the sky, so you could really, really look up at it. I had my camera out. I was looking it through my camera. But it was only like the little bottom of it. And then like just like walking around, you wouldn't really notice. The light did look a little, it looked strange, I would say. Like the light just like in around you kind of looked sort of weird. It had a different kind of quality to it. Mm-hmm. But it was absolutely noticeable if you were staring up at the sun.
Is it, hold on, time out. Is there something wrong with your camera? Normally I can see.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Let me take this.
Is it not on?
Yeah. Let me take this off. Sorry about that.
What is wrong with you?
Yeah, it's not funny. I'll just say that, I really wanted to see the eclipse. I wanted to get some shots of it.
The people who aren't watching this on YouTube, we have to tell right now. Jason has a
shout to the YouTube crew.
Our 6 YouTube viewers are seeing this, but if you're listening in your phone, car, wherever, Jason currently has his right eye bandaged shut, his whole just a blindfold over his, like the guy from Mortal Kombat. Just
you know, the thing is, so. It did look bright. I was looking at it through the camera, and I didn't realize that you're supposed to use, the eclipse glasses or like a fogged out filter. And it hurt for a second, but then it stopped hurting. And I guess that's the nerves burning away. You actually don't feel it after a while that you're doing severe damage. But I smelled it and I pulled away and then, you know, this happened, but it was really cool. It was it was so cool.
It was, we watched it in the backyard. I stayed home from the office. I just worked from home. We also kept our three, the twins and the baby. We let them all stay home from school so we could all watch it together. So it's me, Laramie, the three kids, and then the dogs. We have two dogs. We were all gathered in the backyard, just sort of staring up at the sky. Laramie got eclipse glasses for everybody, so
smart.
We didn't have to burn our
smart
burn our eyeballs out. It was cool though. I could feel as I was staring up at the eclipse, the moon passing in front of the sun. I could feel power inside of me just being unleashed like a superhero.
Yeah.
Remember in the one Superman when the guy's powered by the sun and then in the shade, it was like that, but the opposite. As the sun was eaten by the moon, I just was surging with power. For those 2 minutes, there was 2 minutes of total coverage. I was the most powerful man on the planet.
Now the light from the moon is the light from the sun.
Wait, what?
The light from the moon is just the reflected light from the sun.
Yeah. Jason, so I taught eighth grade science. I know this, Jason. This is one of the 6 science things I know.
He would power no matter what, because it's the light from the sun.
I don't know. We got okay. This got too nerdy. Okay. I was just saying it got dark.
Yeah.
I get powerful in the dark. The guy from the Superman got powerful in the light. That's what I'm saying. You don't have to ruin everything, Jason.
I'm sorry. I texted my mom about the eclipse. She was not impressed. They also had an earthquake back in New York. I texted her, hey, did you feel the earthquake? And she said, No, it wasn't. I'm used to the big earthquakes from the Philippines. And then I texted her about the eclipse. Hey, did you see the eclipse? And she said, yeah, I saw it, but it was not as great as the ones I used to see in the Philippines. Okay, you don't like it? Then go back. You don't like it so much? Sorry, we couldn't get a better eclipse for you, Ma. She doesn't know about my eye yet, so.
She said, get this whack-ass tiny little earthquake out of here. Get this whack-ass.
Get this out of here.
Eclipse out of here. Give me the Philippines. Oh, my God. You want to start the show?
Let's start the show.
I'm so excited. From Wondery, I'm Shea Serrano.
And I'm Jason Concepcion.
And this is Six Trophies.
Hello! Jason Concepcion, and welcome to Six Trophies, a podcast series hosted by myself, Shea Serrano, in which we comb through all the NBA news for the past week and then hand out six pop culture-themed trophies for six basketball-related activities. In this episode, South Carolina puts together the perfect season. The Bucks. It's tough right now. And Edwards gives an all-time great quote. All that and more. Let's hand out some trophies.
The original is back, baby.
Yeah.
We played the original for the first time in several weeks in the last episode. And then I just missed it, and I wanted to use it again. I missed it so much. Are you really going to wear this blindfold over your eye, this gauze over your eye for the whole? You should take it off. You did it. You did the bit. You committed to it. It's incredible. His eye is healed. We do two sets of trophies, the big trophies and the little trophies. The big trophies are first. These ones are the same every week. First up, the Denzel Washington and Training Day trophy. Given out to whoever it is who had the best overall performance of the week. This week's winner, I know we're an NBA podcast, but goodness gracious, South Carolina.
That's my pick.
Come get your trophy.
That's my pick.
Wins the national title, puts together a perfect season, 38-0. Nobody even thought about beating them. Over the past 3 years, 109-3 with two championships. Would have been three were it not for one shaky couple minutes stretch against Iowa last year when they lost in the Final Four. But goodness gracious, South Carolina just looked, they looked like there was no chance they were losing that game. Even at the start.
Even at the start.
The game starts, Iowa comes out in fucking Fast and the Furious Nas mode, going crazy. Caitlin Clark scores 18 points in the first quarter. And it just never felt like, it didn't feel like that, like South Carolina was in danger. They just were like, you know what? All right. They did the too soon junior. Boom, here we come with our Nas. Cardoza's going nuts. Raven Johnson is going nuts. Tessa's going nuts. Oh, my God. You couldn't do nothing with them. They're just too big. Good.
They're too big. The defense was too good. I know it sounds kind of crazy when Caitlin put up numbers again in the game, 30-plus, but, like, they played great defensive on her, didn't really let her set up her teammates in the same way. Stulke, who really carried them for the entire middle of the game against UConn, was negated by the size inside. I mean, Cardozo's just so ferocious, swallowing up everything in there. And she's got some Tim Duncan-esque like post moves and stuff, like is just a heavy load to carry down there, and she was dominating. And then the rest of their roster just came in and was like hitting big shots. You mentioned it. Watkins was great. Raven Johnson was great. Pow Pow was awesome. Like they were like an anaconda, slowly constricting until, you know, by the middle of the third quarter, you just thought there's nothing Iowa can do. They just are locked in the grip.
There's nothing. Cardoza, I tweeted this while I was watching the game. Watching her bully everybody in the paint, just turning the paint into a torture chamber.
Absolutely.
She was like a bulldozer driving through a daycare. Like you just couldn't, there's nothing you could do. Every rebound she was going, what, she have 17 rebounds in the game? Seemed like every time Iowa would start to be like, here we come, we're going to try and do a thing, she would just punch him in the mouth. Raven Johnson, Raven Johnson, that might be my favorite storyline from the game. Raven Johnson is who last year when Iowa beat South Carolina also had a perfect season up until they lost in the Final Four. She was the player who Caitlin Clark just waved off. She's out at the three-point line. We're going to leave her open, just waved her off. Raven Johnson spends the entire year on her revenge tour of devastation. And then here she comes in the championship game. Caitlin goes nuts in the first quarter, 18 points. And then they put Raven on her. 12 points for the rest of the game. Just had her in the Hannibal Lecter straitjacket. And comes back and gets a chance. What an incredible feeling that must have been to be like, nah, not this time. Not this time, my friend.
And what's awesome about it is ratings gold, folks. This game was seen by 18 million plus people.
18.7 it averaged. Oh.
And that makes it the fifth biggest basketball or the biggest basketball game in the last 5 years by ratings.
By ratings. Men's, nuts. Women's, college, pro.
Any game.
This was the tops. This was the NBA number one finals, basketball game.
NBA playoffs. You name it.
Any basketball game you can name in the last 5 years, more people watched this one. And man, oh, what an exciting stretch that was.
It delivered. And again, that's my pick. South Carolina. Well,
yeah, they're South Carolina. that was my pick. Of course that was your pick.
That was my pick before the tournament.
Yeah, it should have been your pick. I know. They were running through everybody all season.
Listen, I'm just saying.
Rebound differential, 51 to 29. I mean,
that was the game right there. That was the game.
Bench scoring, 37 to 0. 37 to 0. You can't win like that. You can't win when Dawn Staley can be like, give me the third person off the bench. She's going to go in and get 9 points real quick. She just kept on bringing people in. They lost last year, and then they bring in five new starters. They lost every starter. They bring in five new ones and are somehow better.
It's
somehow
crazy.
Better. You got to say Dawn Staley's stuff. Name when you're talking about the best
one
basketball
of the
coaches alive.
Absolutely one of the greats.
You got to say her name. It's crazy what she's doing down there.
Yeah, just absolutely one of the greats in the game today. Dawn Staley.
Oh, goodness gracious. Congratulations to South Carolina. You fucking ran through everybody. You destroyed everybody. What an incredible season to
and
go.
Congratulations
perfect.
To Iowa on a fantastic run.
Great run.
All in
super
all,
fun.
just a wonderful season for the game.
Positive experience for everybody involved. Most positive for South Carolina, though. Goodness gracious. Next trophy. The Lauryn Hill, you might win some, but you just lost one trophy. Give it out to whoever it is who had the worst performance of the week. This week's winner, the Bucks. Come on up.
What's going
Come
on?
Come on up and get your trophy. What's going on in Milwaukee? What's going on in Milwaukee, Jason? Jason, they were 30-13 under Adrian Griffin. They bring in Doc, 15-17 under Doc Rivers. What's happening? What's happening in Milwaukee, Jason? That's what I want to know.
Well, for one thing, Doc Rivers has finally taken some blame. Doc Rivers, famed for throwing his players under the bus and has been doing it all throughout his run as Bucks head coach. Not only the players, but ownership also. Hey, can't we, why don't we wait till after All-Star to do this and that? And hey, I guess some of our guys are already in Cancun. He said a couple days ago, the last quote, the last three were against bad teams. To me, that's inexcusable for all of us. As I told them, this is on me. I got to figure out what we got to do to play at a higher pace. Doc Rivers, ladies and gentlemen, it's on him. Finally, it's on him. I mean, this is just, after they lost to the Knicks, I will say a red flag for me that, first of all, Doc took all the starters out. They were down 10, and there was over a minute left, which... for an NBA roster with the stars that the Bucks have and the pedigree that they have, 10 points in today's NBA is not anything. You can cut that real quick. And the the look on the Bucks faces when he emptied the bench was concerning. And then they all huddled up for a prayer afterwards. Folks, the vibes are bad. The vibes are officially very, very bad.
Bad vibes. As we record this, they're on a 4-game losing streak. They lost to Washington. They lost to Memphis. They lost to Toronto.
Memphis with no players.
There's no players.
Much respect to the players who are playing for the Memphis Grizzlies, but they're like multiple 10-day guys on that roster. They lost to them. Mm-hmm.
And then they lost to the Knicks. The Knicks is the only team on that list that you can go like, all right, that's fine. You could lose to the Knicks, even though they're still without Julius Randle. It's fine. Jalen Brunson has been on an all-time heater. You could lose to the Knicks. It's okay. But the other three, man, it's just feeling not great. All of that to say, they're still second in the East. They're still in second place. You still got to think about them a little bit. But I don't know if I feel like I'm not that afraid of them if I'm the other teams in the East right now.
It is definitely strange. They could finish anywhere as low as six. But this and we'll see. Like, we've seen teams throughout the years manage to flip the switch. But these are really concerning losses at the worst possible time. And with Doc already in blame mode, it's it's concerning. I'd be concerned.
This is a question Zuri asked us.
Yeah.
Are the Bucks too old to try and flip the switch?
No.
You mentioned flipping the switch. No,
nah.
Right? They're fine.
Yeah.
Do we trust Giannis, Brooke, Chris, Bobby? They know how to win a championship. They've done it. We trust them here, right?
Absolutely. And Dame, his reputation is solidified as a playoff performer. They just got to find it. They just have to, you know, I put it on Doc. They just have to figure out like what the Dame Giannis chemistry has looked a little shaky all season. Dame very quietly, because people haven't really talked about it, has not really played well offensively. Like, they brought him in for the offense and everything is down across the board. Numbers are down. So he has to play better. They got an injection when Middleton came back and looked good, but they just have to all play well at the same time. And it's not happening.
It's not happening. Will it happen though? Yes or
maybe.
No?
Maybe. No, it's not going to happen.
When do they lose in the playoffs?
Let's see. Where are they slotted? Well, first of all, where do they finish? What do you think? Where do they finish? Do they between?
I think they hold steady.
Sitting at the second.
I think they hold steady at second.
Okay. So let's say they play the 76ers in the first round.
Ew. We talked about them playing Boston last week. No, I don't think anybody wants to play the Sixers. That's a sneaky 7-8 seed. Uh-oh.
I got to say, I don't think the Sixers would be the favorite in that series, but I'm going to pick them to win just for the drama. I'll pick them to win. And the Sixers are on a win streak since Embiid came back. Maxi playing great. Embiid playing much better than anybody expected. And I would not want to see them. Nobody wants to see them. But if you're the Bucks, you really do not want to see the Sixers at seven in the first round.
The Sixers are going to ruin somebody's season. That's what's going to happen. That's what it feels like. They're sending somebody home early that wasn't expecting to go home early. That's what's going to happen. Because they're supposed to be, the Sixers should have been the second or third seed, but now they're down at the bottom and it's looking a little treacherous. Next trophy, the Dominic Toretto. I live my life a quarter mile at a time trophy, given out to the person or team who made a short-term decision with no regard for future consequence. I love this week's winner.
I love it.
The Houston Rockets for taunting the Warriors. And then real quick, it came back to him.
It came back real quick.
will you explain what happened here?
Sure. So as you know, we've been talking about, the Rockets have been hot on the heels of the Warriors and the Lakers and everybody else there at the bottom of the playoff range. They were on a heater. Houston's Tari Eason. So Tari first posted a video on his Instagram of him saying, "Warriors come out to play, yay." This, of course, a reference to the to the famed action film of the late 70s, The Warriors, the end scene. Luther, the villain from The Warriors, leader of the Rogues, tracks the Warriors down to at their base in Coney Island and puts three bottles on his hand, clinks them together and says, "Warriors, come out to play." And then what happens? They need to, Rockets got to win this game, important game versus the Warriors. And guess what happens? The Warriors just flex and wipe them out. 133 to 110. Oh, come on.
Tough break. Tough break. You're, listen, I will say, Tari, Tari was in the right in talking shit ahead of time. You talked shit beforehand.
Yes. That great I respect.
Job. Great.
I respect it.
Great. You do it before, not after. But then you got to go out there. First of all, he doesn't really play, which is fine. I thought Draymond had like a really... I thought Draymond had a great line in his podcast where he was talking about this thing. And he said, it's kind of tough coming out yelling, come out and play. And you're not going to play. But I respect it. This is great. Okay. Talk shit ahead of time. Great. Checked off. But you got to win that game. You can't lose that game because now everything is turned around on you. Steph is on the bench recreating the bottle clinking
the
moment.
On his,
on his fingers. You got to know this is the Warriors, but they are expert shit talkers.
Yes.
Expert. Top Just level. They will always make fun of you. They will always make fun of you.
You gotta
win that game.
Let them sleep. Don't come at them and give them any extra juice because it will come back to bite you. And it really did. It really did. I love the shot of Tari on the bench, Dylan Brooks, both of them looking so like downtrodden. Yeah. And Tari's wearing the shirt. And it's and they just look like, oh no, we've made a
That's
mistake.
That's crazy
we
to have the have shirt been. On while you're getting beat.
Yeah, come on.
That's crazy.
But I love
shout
it.
Shout out the Warriors.
I do love the energy, but you're absolutely right, man. You gotta win or you gotta
you
own
gotta
this
win
one.
That game.
You gotta
you
own
gotta
that
win
one.
That game.
You gotta own it. You gotta own that
Next
one.
Next trophy. Next trophy. The Daniel Plainview. I've abandoned my child. I've abandoned my boy trophy, which is given out to a player or team who is temporarily giving up on something. This week's winner, Anthony Edwards, for abandoning his teammates in the third quarter against the Lakers. He's given up on passing. That's what he's given up on more than his teammates. He's given up on passing.
Yeah, the Timberwolves, huge game. The Lakers have been on a heater. AD playing great the entire... the Lakers
that's,
really
that's
humming.
That's three heater mentions. We've got three heater mentions so far.
I mean, the bottom of the West is boiling, folks. it was a tight game going into the third quarter. And then Anthony Edwards went and just exploded and was asked about it later. And he said, quote, "I passed enough. Now it's time to score." I love it.
What a great line. I passed enough. Now it's time to score.
What a great line.
I'm certain I've said a version of that at the park after making one pass. One pass and like, that's it. Time to score, baby. Time to get these shots up. I love Anthony Edwards. I love watching him play basketball. We've talked about him time and time again on the show. We are big Anthony Edwards fans. I'm so excited for the playoffs. I'm so excited to watch him in the playoffs. But more than just watching him play, I'm so excited to hear what he has to say. What's going to happen when they win a big game? What's he going to say? What's he going to say when they lose a big game? Because it's going to happen. He has my attention.
Timberwolves currently sitting at 54-24 at the top of the West. Tied by record with the Nuggets, also 54-24, which is why every win right now is absolutely crucial. Number one could end up playing anybody from, man, I mean, Lakers-Warriors currently slotted down there at that 9-10 play-in. Timberwolves-Warriors, Timberwolves-Lakers, Nuggets-Lakers, like Nuggets-Warriors like in the like first
it.
Round.
I would like it. I would like
in
it.
In the first round, folks.
I would like it.
Oh my gosh. It's gonna be crazy. Huge win. And to your point, Anthony Edwards, I think in terms of faces of the league coming up here. We've got a lot of young talent waiting in the wings when LeBron finally exits. And I got to say, in terms of like just quotability, Ant Edwards for me could be the face of the league coming up. I know that Wemby is putting up numbers that we've never seen, literally never seen. But never. In terms of like saying stuff, yeah. There it is. You got to love Ant Edwards.
Did you see his logo? Did you see Wemby's logo?
I did see the logo.
Assumed logo, the alien basketball placed into a cornfield.
It's his logo. I'm going to say that it is his logo. I did see it. It was pretty cool.
Very cool. Very cool. Next trophy. The Chief Keef. That's that shit I don't like trophy, which is given to a player or team who does something. We just don't like it. We don't like it. I don't like it. This week's winner. Oh, man. What a bummer. Julius Randle out for the season.
It sucks. It sucks. It sucks. He tried to gut it out to get back for the playoffs. It didn't work out. We'll have surgery on a torn labrum. And it really hurts. You know, OG has been playing, so that helps. But we're really going to need him. And it stinks. It stinks. He's been out ever since. He injured his shoulder against the Heat and getting tangled up with Jaime Jaquez, and it sucks. But luckily, thankfully, every day I get on my knees and I thank the Lord that we have Jalen Brunson, that the Knicks have Jalen Brunson, because legitimately he is the best point guard that we've had since Clyde Frazier. The stats back that up, and thank God we have him. I saw there was a stat, I texted it to the Six Trophies thing. The total number of 30-point games by a Knicks starting point guard in the 15 years before Brunson, it's like Emmanuel Mudiay, remember him, with 3 30-point games. Then it's Chauncey Billups, who was absolutely on his last legs, fumes coming out of his body with 2. Derrick Rose, same, with 2. And then Raymond Felton and a whole bunch of other guys with 1. And then it's Jalen Brunson with 49 30-point games. That lets you know how badly the Knicks have needed a point guard in the last 20 years.
He's great. I'm so He's happy great. For him.
Thank God
I'm
for him.
So happy. Zuri, last week, I think it was last week, we mentioned we needed a sound for Jalen Brunson, like how we have the angel sounds for my guy. Do you have some options available for us to listen to for Jalen Brunson? Listeners, please save Zuri's job. Just find a sound. What's a sound that makes sense when you hear Jalen Brunson's name? Like when you hear Wimby's name, the angelic chorus, that makes sense. We need something like that. All right. Save Zuri's job. Next trophy. The Step Brothers Catalina Wine Mixer Trophy, given out to the thing we're most excited about for the upcoming week. We just sort of almost kind of talked about it. This week's winner, Lakers Warriors battling it out. You got 1 week left. They're going to play each other in the play-in.
What? We've tried to ignore it. We wanted to ignore it. I have been eager to dismiss either one of these teams, the mid-league Lakers. And the cooked Warriors, what's happened? Now they're playing well. Now they're playing great. All of a sudden, Clay has found his groove. He's saying stuff like, oh my God, I've really figured out this whole thing about how to have a smaller role and come off the bench, and I've like figured it all out. It's coincidental timing now that he's up for a big contract. Well, we'll see. Everybody's playing well. AD's killing it. D'Lo's killing it. Austin Reeves killing it. Rui Hachimura in the starting lineup has transformed this Lakers team. And now all of a sudden they could play each other in the play-in for what will surely be the most ballyhooed and ratings bonanza play-in ever. I can't believe this has happened.
I think it's super, super interesting, super cool that the LeBron-Curry rivalry, really the LeBron-Warriors rivalry, because it's always him against the Warriors, not just Steph, but it's him against the Warriors, has now stretched from...
I just picture like all the rest of the Lakers taking off their headphones and throwing them down. Like at that part, they get to this part of Six Trophies and they're just like, fuck! Damn! God damn it!
That rivalry, LeBron versus the Warriors, we watch them play in what is arguably one of the two or three greatest ever finals series.
I think the greatest of my life.
Game 7 for me, 2016, yeah. Right? We watched them all. They played all the way in that. Played in the finals against each other multiple times. But that was the pinnacle of it, 2016. The 73-9 Warriors against the LeBron, Kyrie, Kevin Love Cavs. And Game 7. Like, that's as high up as you can get on the mountain. We've watched that. And then now here they are still battling each other, but now for the play-in spot. Like, it has reached the expanse of possibilities for rivalries, and it's super, super cool. I really hope we get somehow Lakers-Warriors playing against each other. It looks like it's going to happen. There's certainly a chance that it could happen. It's all in play. We've got 1 week left. Oh, please give it to us. Give it to us.
Here's, I want to read this Clay quote from who reported this. This is from NBC Sports Bay Area. Tristy Rodriguez got this quote. Clay, as time goes on, you realize how demanding this job really is. It's so physically demanding. I was actually struggling a lot with that at the beginning of this year because of the unknown. I guess Clay was just like, yeah, it's going to be easy. Continue to be easy. Oh, wait a second. This is a little hard. Oh,
hold on a second.
This is... Oh, this is hard all of a sudden.
This is difficult.
But man, they're figuring out. He's been through, of course, like two of the worst injuries that you can have in sports.
Just keeps on coming back.
If this is the last gasp of them, either one of these teams, the Lakers and LeBron and this Warriors core, it's been really fun. It's been fun.
It's been as fun as it can get. It's been the most fun. When they finish playing each other, it's going to feel like when Rocky and Apollo Creed finish
fighting
each other. That's
exactly what it's going to feel like.
Hey, great job on both sides. Yeah. Everybody won some, everybody lost some, but we're all a little bit better for it.
That's right.
That's it right there. You want to do the little trophies?
Let's do them.
Yes. Let's do the little trophies. These ones change each week and are situation specific. They're for the smaller storylines that we want to mention, but don't need to get all the way into. My first little trophy. Oh, man. I should have saved this I mentioned it earlier, but the James Earl Jones. This field, this game is part of our past, right? It reminds us of all that once was good, and it could be good again. Oh, people will come, right? People will most definitely come, right? Trophy to Nike for their new Wemby logo. It reminded me. They put it in a giant cornfield, which is why I picked Field of Dreams. I should get bonus points for that. But also, it just reminded me, this is a tough season for the Spurs, but we're going to be good again. It reminded me we used to be good. Of all that once was good. We're going to be good again.
My first little trophy is the Ween, I understand it, but I don't want it, trophy, to Ruffles potato chips. Shout out to this post on the New York Knicks Reddit by Roly_Gomez, who walked into his local bodega and saw, or supermarket establishment, and saw Ruffles barbecue potato chips with Jason Tatum's picture on it in New York State. His caption is the same caption that I would have. Why the fuck are these being sold in New York State? Who do I complain about this? 100% agree. And I think fans in New England would not want to see Jalen Brunson's face on a bag of chips in their area. Let's figure this out, Ruffles. This is the wrong market for these particular chips.
Wrong market. San Antonio is a big Dallas Cowboy city. And there was a time in the 90s when they were really good and winning all the Super Bowls. When they would play the Eagles, the grocery stores in San Antonio would not sell Philadelphia cream cheese. It was unavailable to purchase. You couldn't buy it. That's what you should do. Get them out of here.
Come on, figure this out.
My next little trophy, the Miklo and Blood In, Blood Out. When you expect nothing and you get everything, that's destiny trophy. To Isaiah Thomas, he's back, baby. The Suns are signing him for the remainder of the season.
Got him locked up.
I'll take it. Congratulations, Isaiah. I missed you so much. I'm so happy you're back.
One of my favorites.
Oh, God. One of my absolute favorite basketball players. A memory hero. A memory hero of mine. Just somebody I think about him playing basketball, and it makes me happy. I'm so happy that he's back in the NBA. He deserves to be here. He should have been here. Sign him for next season, too. Let's keep him in the league.
My next little trophy is the Passion Pit Little Secrets Trophy. This is a dual winner to Ivica Zubac, one, who said of guarding Nikola Jokic and Domas Sabonis, quote, "I found some things I don't want to share that will help me." That's right. He knows what to do. He cracked the code. And if you want to know what the code is, he's not going to tell you. And shouts to Mikel Arteta, the manager of Arsenal. They play Bayern Munich later today, as we are taping this on Tuesday morning. And he was asked, "Hey, did you call your friend Xabi Alonso, the manager of Leverkusen, about how to beat Bayern Munich?" And he said, "That's a very good question. No comment." That's right. Keep your secrets.
My last little trophy, the Highlander. There can be only one trophy. Christopher Lambert, great actor.
Great movie. Fun. Highlander, incredible film.
Highlander's so good. Cut that guy's head off. Remember when he's in Raiden in Mortal Kombat?
Yeah.
The last guy, I mean. Yeah,
yeah.
The Highlander, there can be only one trophy to TJ McConnell. Because this great quote from Miles Turner. Here's the quote. "I think he," talking about TJ, "I think he takes it personal when he sees white boys guarding him. That's just another thing I see from him. He wants to be the white boy. There can only be one white boy. And TJ McConnell wants it to be him."
My final trophy, little trophy, is the Children of the Corn, No Wait, Bring Malachi Trophy too.
I was terrified of Malachi when I was a kid.
Who was not scared?
Oh my God.
Who was not scared of Malachi? Just had that terrible aspect to him. Two, who else? It's got to be Malachi Flynn, folks. For the most random 50 in NBA history, Malachi Flynn shouts to you 50 points versus the Hawks. Knicks legend Malachi Flynn. Josh Hart called him evil Dante DiVincenzo, and I get it. 50-point outburst for Malachi Flynn, then scored 3 points against the Grizzlies and 3 points against the Nets. But incredible. I mean, you'll take this one and show your kids that you scored 50 once in the NBA, and I hope you do it again. I hope you do it again. Malachi Flynn shouts to you.
No Wait, Bring Malachi. What a great pool. What a great pool, Jason. I thought I had this. I know we don't keep score. I know there's no winner or loser here. I thought I had this week little trophy section sewn up with James Earl Jones, Field of Dreams, because they just do a Wemby logo in a field, in a cornfield. I thought I had it sewn up. I think you got me with No Wait, Bring Malachi.
Shouts to Children of the Corn, one of the classic, weird, creepy horror movies of the 80s.
When that ground got to rolling,
ooh.
Watching that as a kid, what the fuck is going on? Is that the devil? Is that the
scary.
Devil doing that? Oh, my God. We did it again, Jason.
Another perfect episode.
Yes. Oh, Zuri was not perfect, though. Save Zuri's job. We need a Jalen Brunson sound. I forgot he has that sound in his soundboard. I gotta stop setting him up for that. We close every episode just by saying the names of underappreciated old basketball players with no context at all while the theme music carries us out. Zuri, will you play the theme music, please? I'm Shea Serrano. That's Jason Concepcion. Producer Zuri in the shadows making the noises. See y'all next Wednesday. Tell us Frank.
Ooh, I'm going all Lakers. Tony Smith.
That's crazy because I'm going all Warriors. Winston Garland. We didn't plan this out ahead of time.
We didn't plan this out.
We just did it.
Oh, man. Slava Medvedenko.
Oh, Slava Medvedenko. Orlando Graham.
Nice. Admo. Adam Morrison.